Well, good morning, Rockpoint. Would you guys stand to your feet as we worship this morning? We're going to praise our God again and again for who he is and what he's done. We'll sing "When the Doubt in My Way."
When the doubt in my way tries to steal what you say, saying I have no reason to praise, I will give thanks.
Yes, we will.
I will give thanks. When all that I hear is the voice of my fear, trying to silence this hope in my heart, I will give thanks. I will give thanks.
A song.
A song of thanksgiving is my battle cry. With joy as my weapon, I stand and defy the light of the dark with my hands lifted to the sky.
Come on.
I will rejoice. I will rejoice. Oh, I will dance in your kindness and claim every yes and amen. I will rejoice. I will rejoice. My battle cry, with joy as my weapon, I'll stand and defy the light of the dark with my hands lifted to the sky.
While we believe this.
The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. And I'll never stop, oh, I'll never stop. No, nothing can stop my praise. I will rejoice, I will rejoice. Oh, I will dance in your kindness and claim it.
I don't always get to see, but You are good, it's true. keep walking, babe. You keep walking, babe. Father, you are good, Lord, and faithful. Lord, you never change. Lord, and I pray that we remember that. We remember your faithfulness in times of uncertainty, when we're facing trials. Lord, that you're with us every step of the way. You never leave. God, so we look to you, we cling to you, our firm foundation, our solid rock. Come have your way in this place. We love you, we praise you. In your holy and precious name, we all said, amen. Amen, church. You can go ahead and have a seat.
Welcome to Rock Point. I'm Julia, and we are so glad you're joining us this weekend. We'd love for you to grab your phone and visit rockpoint.io. This is the best place to follow along with the sermon, take notes, and find everything happening here at Rock Point. Are you joining us for the first time today? We'd love for you to connect with us at New Here Start Here out on the patio. We have a gift for you and we can't wait to meet you. If you're watching online, connect with us at rockpoint.io under the New Here Start Here tab. Each year, the women of Rock Point come together to align our focus on our Savior as we enter the Christmas season. Join us for Silent Night, Tuesday, November 30th, as we enjoy the sparkle of the holiday and soak in the history of Jesus, the account from the manger to the cross. Invite your friends and register now at rockpoint.io. Are you new to Rock Point? We would love to see you at our next newcomer dinner on Saturday, December 4th at 6:30 p.m. This is a great opportunity to make new friends and discover all the ways you can get plugged into community. There will be free dinner and fun games, and your kids can join too. This year, we have an incredible opportunity to host Angel Tree. Check this out.
Hey guys, I'm David, founder of Purpose Movement. This year, Purpose Movement has an incredible opportunity to come together with 180 Prison Support Ministry to help sponsor Rock Point Church Angel Tree. Angel Tree is an outreach ministry where we partner together as a church body. We supply gifts for local kids in our community who are in the foster system or have parents who are currently incarcerated. Rock Point is so excited to sponsor as many kids as possible, and Purpose Movement is going to come alongside us and will be matching up to 250 kids. In order to reach this goal, we're asking for your help. We would love for you to pick up a tag or sign up to serve at the tables out on the patio. We're so excited about the impact we're going to be making this Christmas season.
Together with Purpose Movement and 180 PSM, we are excited to make Christmas special for kids in our community this year. Our mission here at Rock Point is to point people to Jesus by loving them like Jesus. Thank you for your faithful giving. We don't receive the offering in service, but you can give online at rockpoint.io under the Give tab to set up your recurring financial gift. Or we have offering boxes near the exits in the worship center and the lobby. Thanks for joining us this weekend. Let us know if we can help you in any way. Make sure to follow us on social media and connect with us on rockpoint.io for everything happening here at Rock Point.
Well, what's up, Rock Point? Man, did anybody come excited about Jesus this morning? All right, that was just like slightly weak. That was like, oh, let me just appease this guy real quick. Let's try this one more time. Did anybody come excited about Jesus this morning? There it is. Hey guys, my name is Brent. I serve as one of the pastors at your sister church, Cornerstone Church, and I am so grateful and thankful for the opportunity to come this morning and serve here at one of the greatest churches in the world, Rock Point Church. Hey, save those claps because I want to make sure you do a clap for this guy. Can we give it up for one of the greatest pastors on this side of heaven? None other than your lead pastor, Pastor Bill Bush. Shout out to him. I know he's watching online. Shout out to he and his wife, Carrie. Thank you guys so much for the way that you serve this community, the way that you serve this church, and the impact that you guys are making on the kingdom is going to last for generations to come. So we thank you. So y'all, I'm excited to get ready to jump into the word. But before I do, I'm considered a Bapticostal. And us Bapticostals, we love prayer. So would you do me a favor and join me in a brief word of prayer? Father, I give you glory, honor, and praise, and I thank you so much for this opportunity to stand and to proclaim your word. I decrease and ask that you would increase, hide me behind the cross. Let me say only what it is that you want me to say and nothing more than that. Give me preaching power that comes from your Holy Spirit, and I pray that when we leave this place today, that we would leave here knowing that you have an undeniable and unconditional love for us, and that we would have a relentless commitment to you. We thank you, we bless you, we praise you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray and give thanks. And everybody said, amen. So I thought it would be a really cool idea this morning if I did what's called the Milk Crate Challenge live on stage in front of all of you. By show of hands, how many of you all know what the Milk Crate Challenge is? Okay, a good portion of you. For those of you who do not know what the Milk Crate Challenge is, the goal is for me to essentially climb up all of these milk crates without falling and getting to the other side. Let me check your faith. How many of you all think I can actually do this without falling? I have one request. I see the guy right here. Please don't record me. I don't want to go viral for all the wrong reasons. So here it is. This is a lot higher than I thought. Let me get that stretch in real quick. All right, step one, here we go. Come on. All right, step two. Man, the more I go higher, the more intimidating this becomes. Before I take the second step, I want you to watch this video of what happens to most people that do the Milk Crate Challenge. Check this out. Upon further review, I've decided that it's in my best interest not to do the Milk Crate Challenge. Thank you. But there's something that I want you all to notice about that video. Everyone in that video was different shapes and different sizes. And some of those folks in that video, they actually had pretty athletic builds. Like you would look and say, man, they could probably do the Milk Crate Challenge. But none of those people were successful at doing the Milk Crate Challenge. And the reason why is because it had nothing to do with their shape. It had nothing to do with their size. But it had everything to do with the fact that they were trying to walk on a foundation that's not secure. And here's the truth of the matter, is that sometimes some of us try to walk through our lives on a foundation that's not secure. We spend so many years working on building up our careers, working on building up the biggest bank account, working on making sure that we've got a 3-bedroom, 2-bathroom house with a nice picket fence in the backyard, making sure that the world looks at us and they see our status and say we're extremely successful. And let me say right now that there is absolutely nothing wrong with any of those things. But Jesus makes it abundantly clear in Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these other things will be added to you. The truth of the matter is Jesus wants you and I to make him our foundation. That if we're going to walk through this life, we have to walk through this life with Jesus and with the gift of his Holy Spirit. And in just a moment, we're going to look at Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 through 29. But I want to give you the big idea this morning. The big idea is simply this. It's never too early nor too late to start listening, following, and building your life upon Jesus. Say it again. It's never too early nor too late to start listening, following, and building your life upon Jesus. If you have your Bibles, open with me to Matthew chapter 7. Again, we're going to look at verses 24 through 29. Let me paint the picture of what's taking place in the text. Y'all, Jesus is giving the greatest sermon that has ever been preached in human history in this passage. It's called the Sermon on the Mount, and it is a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful message. And what Jesus basically does in these five verses, verses 24 and 29, he paints the picture of the difference of the lives of two men. One man is building his life on sand, which is our milk crates over here, and the other man is building his life on Jesus, which is a solid foundation, these cinder blocks over here. And in just a moment, I'm going to unpack what it is that Jesus is saying in these verses. Now, I gotta give you a warning. I'm probably gonna say some things during this sermon that's gonna be a little hard. It's gonna be challenging, but I want you to lean in, and if you feel bad, don't throw stones at me. That's the Holy Spirit that's convicting all of us. Amen. With that being said, let's go ahead and run through these passages. We're going to begin at verse number 24. Here's what Jesus says. He says, anyone who listens to my teaching and follows it is wise, like a person who builds a house on solid rock. Now, what Jesus was saying at this time and what the Holy Spirit is speaking to you and I this morning is essentially this. Any man or woman, boy and girl, who comes to church and listens to the message that's being taught, but then takes that message and puts it into practice, actually does what it says, is wise. And wisdom is nothing more than taking spiritual principles and applying them to life situations. What happens so often is in our culture today, Christians typically like to attend church, unfortunately, 1.8 times a month. And that was the pre-COVID number. And what we often like to do is and I'm talking about Rock Point because you guys are awesome, but churches all across America outside of here, let me tell you what takes place on Sunday morning. We roll in on Sunday morning with our families, and we get our kids checked in. And, of course, we got to have our cold brew because we're super fancy. So we go and we order our cold brew. We listen to the message. Church gets out. We have this amazing experience with other people that we do fellowship with. But the problem is we have allowed church to just simply be a social gathering. And Jesus is saying to you and I this morning that my design for church was never for it to be a social gathering, but my design for church was for it to be a place of spiritual transformation and spiritual impartation. And the unfortunate part is there are so many people who do know Jesus. They've confessed Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And I honestly believe that they'd even love Jesus. But unfortunately, they treat their relationship with Jesus as if it's something that is casual. And Jesus is saying to you and I this morning, I don't want you to be a casual Christian. I want you to be a committed Christian. You see, a casual Christian looks at the Bible, they look at scripture, they look at text, and they say, Jesus, I like that scripture, I like that scripture, I like that scripture, but that one ain't for me. You ain't write that one for me. That's what casual Christians do. But a committed Christian says, God, I like that one, I like that one, I like that one, and even though I'm struggling with that one, I'ma still say yes to your will, and I'ma still say yes to your way. That's the difference between the casual Christian and the committed Christian. And one of the things that I've got to tell you right now is I don't want you to think, as you'll hear me continue to talk through this message, that I'm trying to teach you about behavior modification. That's not what I'm trying to teach you, because that's not what Jesus taught. Jesus never taught behavior modification. But Jesus did teach spiritual transformation. You see, the reality is the moment that you said yes to Jesus, he has sealed you with his promised Holy Spirit. And when he sealed you with his promised Holy Spirit, he gave you the ability to be free from the things that separate you from him so that you can live in an experience and a relationship with him. A few months ago, I made a brand new friend, y'all. I love my new friend. I called my new friend. I told him I was preaching here at Rock Point. He said I had permission to tell this story. So I met my new friend on a Sunday morning. He comes up to me after service is over. He says, "Hey, Pastor Brent, I need to talk to you really quickly. I'm a brand new believer. And the truth of the matter is I really want to get to know what's in this Bible. Would you be willing to walk with me and show me the things that are in this Bible?" And man, I said, "Absolutely." As a matter of fact, I'll get a couple of guys and we can do a group together. And when I say this guy is a brand new believer, y'all, I mean, he was brand spanking new. I looked at his Bible. He had the red letters in it. And I was like, "Man, those red letters are really cool." He was like, "What are those?" Right, that's how a brand new of a believer this guy was. But this guy was committed to listening, following, and building his life upon Jesus. Now, here's what I need you to know about my friend. My friend is engaged. He's going to get married next summer. But he and his fiance have been together for 8 years. Didn't know Jesus for 8 years. Which means for 8 years, while they've been together, they've had some experiences that Jesus only wants married people to have. There are kids in the room, so I'm trying to keep this G-rated. Got me. Here's what happens. So we're meeting and we're doing our group, and we're like 3 or 4 weeks into it at this point. And then we come across this passage in Matthew chapter 5. Now, the interesting thing, this passage in Matthew chapter 5, the preacher preached on it that Sunday. We talk about it in our small group that Monday. And what ends up happening is that this particular passage, Jesus says, "Hey, if your eye is causing you to sin, gouge it out. And if your hand is calling you to sin, cut it off." Now, for those of you who are new believers, I want you to know that Jesus is not preaching that you mutilate your body. That's not what this text is saying. But what Jesus is saying is, if there's anything in your life that is hindering you from building a relationship with me, you need to remove that thing out of your life. So my friend comes to the small group and he says, "Guys, here's the reality. Me and my fiance, we've been together for 8 years. We already have a kid together. We're getting married next summer. We've clearly had sex outside of marriage, but I know that that's not God's will for my life. I know that's not what it means to be a good Christian. Like, I need some help." I said, "I got some good news for you. Here's the good news. Your friend here, Mr. Brent Hatchett, just so happens to be a pastor. We got two options. Option one, bro, all you got to do is go down to the courthouse, bring me that marriage certificate, and I can marry you next week. I mean, I can do it privately. We can enjoy the celebration next summer. But you can go ahead, we can get married next week, and you can go on about living your merry little life the way that you do. Option two, you wait the 8 months." Now, naturally, because my friend is a guy, you all know which option he leaned towards. Option A, amen. Hello, somebody. So my friend says, "Hold up, let me just go talk to my fiance about it." Here's what I need you to know about. When you listen, follow, and build your life on Jesus, it's not always easy, but it is always worth it. Watch this. He goes home, he talks to his fiance. He says, "Bae, I met with Pastor Brent today, met with our small group today. They said, here, we got two options, because I know we're both trying to do this Christian thing right. Option A, he could marry us privately, and we can have a celebration in the summer. Option B, we can practice abstinence, and then get married in the summer and still live our merry little lives." Y'all, this is what his fiance does. She looks at him in the face and says, "I have never been more attracted to you than I am right now. And our 8 years of being together, you are leading our family, you are following Jesus, and this is so awesome." And then she says, "Let's wait the 8 months." So would you guys do me a favor and pray for my friend? He's got a long 8 months ahead of him. He's gonna make it though. But my point is this. My friend's a brand new believer, but Jesus calls him wise because he's listening and he's following and he's building his life upon Jesus. And there's some of you here today who are in similar situations. It may not be what he had going on, but it could be some other things that you've got going on. And I want to let you know right now, the thing that you're holding on to, it's not worth your relationship being hindered with Jesus. Jesus is so much better than that thing. I want you to look and see what Jesus says to people who listen, follow, and build their lives on him. He says in verse 24, again, anyone who listens to my teaching and follows it is wise, like a person who builds a house on solid rock. Watch verse 25. Though the rains come in torrents and the floodwaters rise and the winds beat against that house, it won't collapse because it is built on bedrock. Remember I told you, listening, following, and building your life on Jesus isn't easy. Truth of the matter is, Jesus made us a promise. He said, in this life, you will have trouble. And it doesn't matter if you're a believer or a non-believer. Trouble always seems to find a way to try to knock on your door. But here's the beautiful part. When you listen, follow, and build your life upon Jesus, the way you respond to trouble, the way that you deal with trouble, the way that you handle trouble, is completely and totally different from the person who hasn't listened, followed, and built their life on Jesus. There's a benefit to when you and I sincerely, with all of our hearts, all of our minds, all of our souls, go all in and say, I'm going to be as committed as possible to being a follower of Christ. Because what I can testify today is that there have been some difficult moments in my life, but through every moment that's been difficult, I can stand with all authority and say that God has kept me. And there's something amazing that happens when you walk through life and you go through life's challenges, but you get to experience that moment when God has kept you. Here's the reality. Instead of doing the milk crate challenge, y'all, I want to switch things up. This morning, I want to do something called the Jesus challenge. And this is the Jesus challenge. The Jesus challenge is when you and I make the commitment to say, I'm going to listen, I'm going to follow, and I'm going to build my life on Jesus. Now, Pastor Brent, how do you do that? I'm so glad you asked. Let me explain. The way you listen, follow, and build your life on Jesus is, number one, you want to make sure that the foundation of your life is the Word of God. You see, the truth of the matter is, what casual Christians do is they'll open up their Bible app once a week, they'll look at the scripture, meditate on that, and then not look at it again for another 2 or 3 weeks. But a committed Christian says that I know that there is power in this Word. That this word is alive and active and that it is sharper than any two-edged sword. And the truth of the matter is that there are some of you here who are unfortunately are probably going to experience spiritual warfare one day because the enemy does not want to see you blessed. The enemy does not want to see you have the joy of the Lord. The enemy does not want to see you victorious. But here's what I can tell you right now, that when I fight my battles against the enemy, I don't fight my battles with human wisdom. I don't fight my battles with the words of the world. I fight my battles with the words of the Word, because the Word has never failed and the Word will never fail. God's Word is true, alive, breathing, and active. And when you tap into the Word of God, you tap into power. So number one, you build your life with a foundation on the Word of God that leads to spiritual transformation. But then here's the second thing that you do. Y'all, don't let me fall in Jesus' name. The second thing that you do, come on, let me do like my man. You know what, I ain't gonna get there. He fell. Human wisdom, not good. But here's the second thing that you do. You build your life on my two twins, grace and mercy. You see, the truth of the matter is that every Christian in this life, we need the grace of God. And grace is God giving you something that you don't deserve. All of us should have been dead to our sins and our transgressions. But yet God has given us his grace, which is aligned with his hope, his peace, his joy, his goodness, his kindness. He has given us his grace, which is a free gift for you and I to inherit as kids to the kingdom. So we want his grace, but then the second thing we all need is we need his mercy. And I think I'm in a room full of real people who can say, Pastor, I have said some things I wasn't supposed to say. I have been some places I shouldn't have been, and I have done some things I shouldn't have done. But because of his mercy, when I should have lost my marriage, God God kept it together. When I should have lost my job, I'm still gainfully employed. When I should have lost my mind because of the foolishness that I did, I'm still in my right mind. We need God's grace and we need God's mercy. And when you build your life on the word of God, and then you build your life on the grace and the mercy of God, this is where it gets real good, y'all. You get to experience the peace of God. Peace that surpasses all understanding, because winds will blow, torrents will happen, storms will come up in your life. But because you have built this firm foundation, you'll be able to stand on Christ the solid rock and say, no weapon formed against me will be able to prosper, for I am more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. And if God be for me, who in the world can be against me? I will stand on Jesus. I will listen, follow, and build my life upon him, because I have never seen him fail. And there are some people here right now where life has beat you up. There are people here right now where life has done a number on you. And can I encourage you right now to let you know that despite the mistakes you've made, despite the things you said, despite the places you've been, God sent me here to tell you, number one, that he loves you. But he's also sent me here to tell you, number two, if you listen, follow, and build your life on me, man, I will have your back, and I'll cause you to see victory in areas that you didn't see possible. As a matter of fact, I'll do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that you could ask, think, or imagine. Because y'all, we serve a God that is that big, a God that can part the Red Seas, a God that can open doors that no man can shut, a God who defeated death, hell, and the grave, who got up on Sunday morning with all power in his hands. I feel like preaching at a black church right now. And because God is that good, he'll do the same for you. Because he got up, you can get up too. Now, out of curiosity, how many of you all would like to come on this stage and do the milk crate challenge? See, it's always the 10 and 12-year-olds that want to do the milk crate challenge. Just, boy, put your hair down. Here's the thing. Anyone in their right mind knows for a fact that there is no way you're going to get up there and do that milk crate challenge, because you know it's dangerous. So the question that I have for you and I is why is it that we waste our time building our lives over there when we know we should be building our lives over here? That's dangerous. This is wise. Look at what Jesus says in the next couple of verses about people who build their lives over there. I'm stalling to get down because I don't want to fall, so y'all pray for me. Hold on. One step at a time. I done bought these new shoes. They too wide. These bricks too thin. All right, I'm good. Here we go. So check this out. Let's look at verses 26 and 27. He says, but anyone who hears my teaching and doesn't obey it is foolish, like a person who builds a house on sand. And when the rains and floods come and the winds beat against that house, it will collapse with a mighty crash. He says, when you come over here and you start building your life on the things that cannot hold you up, because here's the thing, finances are good, but finances can't hold you up, because all it takes is for another 2008 to come. Family is good, but sometimes family can lose their mind. And all of a sudden, you're trying to figure out whether you want to be in this family or you want to kick them out of the family, right? Sometimes that falls apart. Nice car is good. Nice house is good. That's not the thing that you need to build your life. You want to make sure that you build your life on a firm foundation, and that foundation is Jesus. Hey, husband, your wife needs you to be the head of the home. He needs you to lead. She needs you to lead. She needs you to be the example of what it means to be a follower of Christ. Your kids need you to be the example of what it means to be a follower of Christ. Don't spend so much time building your life over here that you fail to build up your first ministry, which is your family. Hey, wife, your husband needs your prayers. He needs your support. He needs your love. He needs your care. He needs you to be, he needs you to be the type of woman that Proverbs 31 talks about, virtuous woman, raising her children in a manner that feared the Lord and keeps him covered in prayer. Hey, kids, you ain't exempt. You thought I wasn't going to talk about you? I got you, too. Bible talks about how you should honor your mother and father so that your days may be long upon the earth. Parents don't need you talking back. Trust me, my son know what happened when he talked back. Bless his little heart. But could you be not only a good child, but be a model at school? Be salt and light in a dark world. Let the world know that you're public about your faith and your love for Jesus. Don't spend so much time trying to build your life on popularity and being the cool kid or the cool girl in school. But honestly, all you gotta do is live your life for Jesus, and I promise you, you're the coolest kid in the kingdom. Watch this. This summer I was in, but I'm from this city called Miami, Florida, and there's a little city in Miami called Surfside. I lived in Miami for 6 years. I shouldn't say I'm from. I lived there for 6 years. And this summer, there was this high-rise condominium in Surfside, up 25, 30 stories, something like that. And overnight, it collapsed. 98 people lost their lives. Now, here's what's interesting. In 2018, there was actually a survey that was done on that building. I want to read for you just for a moment what the survey revealed about that building. It said that on that building, there was distress and fatigue. There was an abundance of cracking and spalling in concrete beams, columns, and walls. There was failed waterproofing, and it's causing major structural damage. Watch what the surveyor said. They said, failure to replace the waterproofing in the near future will cause the extent of the concrete deterioration to expand exponentially. Y'all, if these folks would have responded to the survey in 2018 about the distress and the fatigue and all the other issues with the foundation of that building, there's a good chance that 98 people would still be with us today. All right, so I know Pastor Bill likes to do throat punch moment. Here's my throat punch moment. If Jesus came down from heaven right now and he came to chill at the service at 11 o'clock at Rock Point Church here in Queen Creek, Arizona, but if he did a survey of your life, what would the survey reveal? Would it show that there's some distress and some cracks in the concrete beams and columns and walls of your walk with Jesus? Would it show that you've got some deterioration because of selfishness, or greed, or gossip, or lust, or gluttony? Pray for me. Because the truth of the matter is, all of us have some areas in our lives that we need to work on. But if we get this right, we won't regret it. And here's the thing. What I'm sharing with you today is not something that I learned out of a textbook. What I'm sharing with you today, as far as listening, following, and building your life on Jesus, I'm sharing with you something that I have lived. And I'm not saying live from the perspective of always listened, followed, and built my life on Jesus. What I'm saying is I once lived one way and figured out how to live the other way. And it's been night and day. As a matter of fact, over here, I was this guy. And my sand, my milk crates, was my family identity. You see, today, my legal name is Brent Anthony Hatchett. But what you don't know is that I was actually born into this world as Brent Anthony Davis Jr. My biological father and my mom had a horrible relationship. As a matter of fact, if you look at my birth certificate, you will notice that my father's name isn't even signed on my birth certificate. It wasn't there the day that I was born. And there were several years, because there was no clarity on what happened, where I was upset with him, and I was mad with him, and even to a degree, maybe upset with her as well. And asking these questions, how come my dad wasn't there? How come he didn't care about me? Does he not love me? Does he not want to be in my life? Eventually, my mom would get married to this guy named Franklin. And Franklin became my hero on earth. because he was there for every basketball game. He took me to the movies. He loved me, and I never, ever, 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 ever felt like a stepson. But there was one issue. For a long time, everybody's last name in the house was Hatchett, but my name was still Davis. And even though I was in the family, I still felt like I was kind of not completely and totally engrafted in. Because I would go to school and the teachers would address my parents as Mr. and Mrs. Davis, but then they would have to correct them and say, I'm sorry, our last name is Hatchett. I would go to the airport and I would present my ID and my family would present their ID and it would take them longer looking at my ID because my last name is different. As a kid, that makes you feel awkward. And my parents did something for me that at the time was the greatest thing. They changed my last name to Hatchett. And I finally felt like I belonged. I finally felt like I was a part of the family. I finally felt like I was in the tribe. And I was building my life on that and everything was amazing and everything was put together until it all fell apart. Because what happened is eventually my parents got a divorce. And I remember begging my parents, would you stay together? Would you stay together? Would you stay together? And they just couldn't make it work. And there was some drama and some trauma that was involved in that entire process. And I was a kid who tried to enjoy life. But secretly, depressed. I would look at the two different houses and say, this is hell on earth. And then I turned 16 and I made God a promise. I said, God, if you allow me to pass my driver's license test, I promise you I'll start taking myself to church. I didn't grow up in a home where we went to church every Sunday. And the real reason I wanted to go to church was, one, I wanted my license. But two, to be honest, y'all, I just didn't want to go to hell. I read books about it. I saw it in movies. That was like, that's not a good idea. Let me try another option. But as I started taking myself to church, I fell radically in love with this man named Jesus. And I stopped building my life on the things over here. And I started building my life on the Word. And on grace and on mercy. And I started to get the chance to experience God's peace. And can I tell you what happened? It didn't happen overnight. Matter of fact, it took several years. I gave my life to Jesus in 2004. 2011, my biological grandmother passes away. She was in Indiana. I was living in Florida. I drove from Florida all the way to Indiana. And when I get to her funeral, lo and behold, guess who's there? My biological dad. We have an exchange. We talk to each other. And slowly but surely, we worked on a relationship. And now, y'all, my biological dad and I are reconciled. He just turned 55, celebrated his birthday a couple days ago. Then there's that fear of my parents got a divorce. How is this going to look? Is it still going to work out? Y'all, I have an amazing relationship with both my mom and my dad. And while their relationship isn't reconciled, my stepdad, who gave me his last name, he is still my hero on earth. He and I still talk every week. But here was my biggest fear. My biggest fear was because I saw an unhealthy marriage. And before I met Jesus, I used to swear up and down I would never get married because I didn't have a good example of a marriage. But I started to listen, follow, and build my life on Jesus. And I've got two kids, and I didn't want to put my kids through what I went through. But I can stand here and tell you that come February, my wife and I will be married 10 years. We've got two beautiful kids, and our marriage is as strong as it has ever been. I didn't do this at the earlier service, but I feel led to do it now. There are some parents right here. This is personal for me. There are some parents who have dealt with what I shared with you right now. Here's what I want to give you some encouragement. If God can keep me through the unfortunate mess you had to live in, then God can keep your kids through the unfortunate mess you had to experience. Don't you dare give up hope. Don't you dare let the enemy think that it can't get better. All I want you to do is listen, follow, and build your life upon Jesus and watch the Lord take care of your kids. Now, I'm going to do something real radical. I ain't going to go up slow. I'm going to go up fast. If you go up slow, you risk falling. That was close, but I made it. I'm going to take a moment of pastoral privilege. There are people here who heard this message today. And as I was speaking, the Holy Spirit was tearing you up inside. Because you know you've either A, you're a non-believer and you need to give your life to Christ, or B, you are a believer, but you've been lukewarm. What's lukewarm? Let me explain lukewarm. Jesus says, I want you to be hot or cold. And I like to always give the illustration of coffee. I have never seen anybody go to the coffee shop and say, can I order a cup of lukewarm coffee, please? No, it's not good. You either get it hot or you get it cold. No in between. Jesus says, I want you to be on fire for me. You've got to make a decision. You either choose sand or you choose a bedrock. You choose a firm foundation. And here's what's about to happen. In just a moment, I'm going to count down from three. And I promise you, this is going to be the best decision you've ever made. The Holy Spirit is in this room and he is working. If you heard this message today and you know you spent more time building things over here, but haven't been doing Matthew 6:33, seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, building things over here, I want you to be bold and stand where you are, but wait till I count down from three. When you stand, the church, the body of Christ, we are going to make a crazy, abundant, loud clap and shout and praise just for you because heaven's gonna rejoice. So again, if you've never accepted Jesus or you know for a fact that you have been lukewarm with your walk and you're ready to change and become on fire for Jesus right where you are, I want you to stand. Three, two, one, stand. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Come on, church. We can do a little bit better than that. Heaven is rejoicing. The angels are singing, holy, holy, holy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to stay standing. Here's what I want you to know. I want to speak to you personally and confirm to you that I don't care what mistakes you've made. I don't care what sins you've committed, that God has a radical, undeniable, unconditional love for you. Not only does he have this undeniable, unconditional love for you, he's got an amazing plan for you, a plan that is so grand and so big that it is going to blow your mind. But if you want to see this plan unfolded in your life, make the commitment as you've already stand and live out the commitment to listen, follow, and build your life upon Jesus. And I promise you, you won't regret it. And as a pastor, can I speak into your life and say right now that no weapon formed against who you are, no weapon formed against your dreams, no weapon formed against your hope, no weapon formed against your peace, no weapon formed against your families, no weapon formed against your spouses or children, it will not prosper, because if God be for you, who in the world can be against you? You are more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus, and everything you need, you already have. Life gets better today than it has been yesterday. I am so excited and so grateful for what God has in store for you. You can be seated. Now, here's what I want you to do. After this service is over, if you stood up, especially if you've never said yes to Jesus and you want to, I want you to go to that door over there to my right. And don't be ashamed, don't be embarrassed. There may be even be a guy or girl in here who was like my friend and you don't even know what the red letters are. That's okay, that's awesome. I want you to go through that door too, because God's got something for you. There's gonna be a group of pastors over there that's ready to pray for you and do life with you. I am so grateful, Rock Point, and so thankful for the chance to come and share this message. I'm gonna pray with us. The band is getting ready to come out. They're gonna sing a song about the goodness of God. And as a church, here's what I want us all to do. I want us to just take a moment and reflect on how good God has been in our lives. And as you reflect on how good God has been in your life, all of us, let's look for that fatigue, that distress, that crack, and say, you know what, Jesus? this is an area that I'm giving to you. Help me get it together. Because you never taught behavior modification, but spiritual transformation. Shape me, form me, and mold me into your image so that you may get the glory out of my life. Let's pray. Father, we give you glory, honor, and praise. Thank you so much for this message today. Thank you for being King of Kings and Lord of Lords. God, my prayer is this, is that you would come and do open heart surgery on us. Give us a heart that loves and seeks after you, to where we won't be focused on building our lives on the things of the world, but we would build our lives on your word. And I know the enemy doesn't fight fair, but I thank you that your word says that no weapon formed against us will be able to prosper. God, we give you glory, we give you honor, we give you praise. And it's in Jesus' name we pray and give thanks. And everybody said, amen.
Goodness of God. Oh.
church, do you believe it this afternoon? He is good and he is faithful always. Let us not forget that as we go about our week. Thank you so much for joining us this Sunday.
Thanks for joining us online this weekend. Let us know if we can help you in any way. Make sure to follow us on social media and connect with us on rockpoint.io for prayer and everything happening here at Rockpoint.